Evaluating past experiences and in charting future courses of action. The Oromo Liberation Front, and indeed all Oromo nationalists, join you in this celebration and are certain that you will achieve ever more victories against the enemies of our people. The victories achieved by you and all Oromo nationalists over erroneous tendencies of neo-governance during the last decade is commendable. Ladies and gentlemen, to many of you from this part of the world, this is the year of George Orwell, and you are engaged in assessing the accuracy of his predictions. And to us Africans, this year has an additional significance as it marks the 100th year since the convening of the notorious Berlin Conference at which the imperialist powers partitioned our continent among themselves. This conference, or the resulting European colonial domination of Africa, is relatively well known. What is not so well known is the fact that an African state, namely Ethiopia, was a party to the partition of Africa and emerged as a colonial power herself. Almost all African peoples have succeeded in reversing the decision of this conference, of the Berlin Conference, in the period after the World War II. To them, direct alien rule is a thing of the past, and they view classical colonialism with only academic interest. However, to us, the inhabitants of the Horn of Africa, and to our brothers in South Africa and Namibia, colonialism continues to be a painful reality. We, unlike other African nations, remember this year as a conclusion of a century of colonial rule. I have mentioned that the imperialist nature of Ethiopia is relatively obscure, but the peoples colonized by Ethiopia and the creators of the Ethiopian Empire have no confusion about their relationship. For decades, the Ethiopian ruling classes boasted of their colonial achievements and behaved accordingly towards the subject nations. Ethiopian history textbooks of the 1950s and 60s attest to this fact. On the other hand, the Oromo and other colonized peoples have never had no confusion about their status as living under alien rule. And indeed, our people view this century as the darkest period in their history. The reinterpretation of Menelik's conquest of our countries as, quote, the reunification of Ethiopia, unquote, is quite a recent phenomenon. It is one of the most recent tricks by the Ethiopian ruling classes to hide the true nature of their empire. But the relentless struggle of the Oromo and other oppressed peoples against Ethiopian colonialism will eventually expose Ethiopia's true nature, as it will lead to the realization of freedom for the oppressed and peace and stability in the whole region. Time does not allow us to show the uninterrupted nature of Oromo people's struggle for independence and national survival. In short, ever since we fell under Ethiopian colonialism, barely as a decade had gone by without one Oromo region or another rising up in arms to throw off alien rule. Compatriots, you share this anniversary with all other Oromo students whose struggle is a manifestation of our people's aspiration for freedom and emancipation. Like your service, the Oromo Students Union in Europe is also celebrating its 10th anniversary. Similarly, Oromo students at home are celebrating their 10th year of struggle under extremely difficult circumstances. When you organize such a gala night to celebrate this important chapter in the history of Oromo students' movements, I implore you to remember your counterparts at home who continue to defy fascist persecution and persevere in furthering the cause of our people at the tremendous risks to their lives. The Oromo Liberation Front as well is celebrating its 10th anniversary this year, not merely by conducting speeches and rallies, but by intensifying the armed struggle. As you all know, decades of Oromo resistance to Ethiopian colonial domination and economic exploitation culminated in the formation of our front in 1974. The OLF was born under and of extremely difficult political situation. The birth of the OLF was made necessary by the refusal of the Ethiopian ruling classes to heed the demands of the Oromo nation for its just right to exist freely. These demands had been expressed both in peaceful and violent means. And the intensification of the policy of destroying Oromo national identity by the current heirs to the Ethiopian Empire imposed upon us a people's armed struggle as the only alternative to win back the rights that naturally belong to us. That is the right to determine our destiny. The difficulties of the Oromo nationalist movement is further compounded by the ambition of a neighboring country to exploit our people's aspiration for freedom to achieve self-aggrandizement. The OLF's survival, and indeed expansion, against all these obstacles, is a testimony to the preparedness of the toiling Oromo masses to pay any price to throw off the yoke of colonial domination cultural subjugation, and economic exploitation. It's an emphatic testimony to the fact that the Oromo masses have said no to colonial domination perpetrated under the fake issue of unity of Ethiopia. And the forces aspiring to partition our country should soberly view our determination to regain freedom and should realize that no people once on the road to emancipation will accept exchange of masters. Considering the geopolitical complications of Oromo Revolution, much has been achieved politically and militarily during the last 10 years, and especially since the recommencement of the armed struggle in 1976. From a tiny force deployed in the Chertem Mountains at the time, the number of our fighters has now grown to thousands operating in the regions of Harargue, Arsi, Bale, and Wollekka. We consider this as an achievement of our masses and above all of our marchers, whose selflessness continues to be a source of courage and determination for the living. Long live the memory of our martyrs. Yet, we should not for a minute forget that much needs to be done at home and abroad. At home, we should and are exerting an all-out effort to expand into new areas where our fighters and politics has not yet reached. The organization of our masses should develop both in quality and in quantity. We must always be ready to combat the enemy's new political moves. This is especially important abroad than at home, for I can assure you that the ruling Ethiopian military junta is completely exposed for the fascist colonial government than that it is. No government has ever so consistently and so persistently taken steps that lead to its being discredited. It has frequently resorted to outrightly cheating our people of the fruits of their labor, including their young ones. This is superimposed over the most rapacious exploitation of our masses, even by the standards of previous Ethiopian colonial regimes. Taxes were increased by hundreds of percentage points. In addition, the ordinary man has to continuously contribute money and property on a numberless of occasions and activities. Contributions in the name of war-affected areas. Contributions in the name of drought-affected communities. Contributions in the name of returning refugees. Contributions to build the local headquarters of the Commission for the Organizing of the Party of the Working People of Ethiopia, and contributions on and on. And in order to carry through such uninterrupted robbery of our people, the colonial bureaucracy has to devise all methods. No trick is too vulgar. No type of coercion is unacceptable. And if need be, armed means to rob entire communities of their cattle, grain and property is allowed. The end result is the total bankruptcy of Ethiopian colonialism. However, it is in the international scene that we still have to expose the nature of Ethiopian colonialism, and especially the nature of the military junta. We are surprised to realize that some of the recent actions of the Ethiopian military junta is given significance abroad, namely its declaration of the formation of the Institute of National Studies and the ongoing preparation to declare the so-called Party of the Working People. But to our people and all other oppressed masses, but our people and all other oppressed masses do not distinguish these from the junta's all previous actions and declarations, which only resulted in more misery for our people and in more power for the military junta. The Ethiopian ruling classes have a long tradition of swindling the world public to win political support and economic aid by promising reform. But in all cases, this political support and economic aid not only resulted in the perpetuation of our people's misery, but in fact, in its intensification. And the present regime has found in the international concern for the hardship of famine-affected communities a golden goose. Unlike its predecessor that covered up the death by starvation of hundreds of thousands of our people to defend its image, the present regime is trading with humanitarian assistance in the most obnoxious manner. It is raising aid abroad, not because of its concern for the lives of the people, but to feed its ever-expanding armed forces and to entice people into its protected hamlets. Humanitarian assistance extended to this type of regime can only result in prolonging and intensifying human suffering. Humanitarian work, in collaboration with a regime that is prosecuting war against a large proportion of the subjects, that persecutes religions, institutions, and persons, that incarcerates, imprisons the most educated elements of the society, and wantonly executes people and displaces their corpses in public squares, can only be counterproductive. Comrades and friends, it is with regards to this that we should work together to effectively expose the nature of Ethiopian colonialism in general and that of the present regime in particular. We should not allow their tradition of hoodwinking the world public opinion to continue to succeed. You, foremost students in foreign lands, have and should play an important role in exposing the colonial nature of Ethiopia and the justness of our people's struggle. Much has been achieved with regards to this, but much more needs to be done. Our strategy should be to foster a people-to-people relationship, which is the only true basis for the achievement of justice and peace in the world. We would like to repeat our warning to the superpower that continues to extend military, political, and diplomatic support to the Ethiopian ruling junta to realize the futility of propping up a mortally wounded, archaic system. Similarly, the other superpower that is trying to woo the junta by extending economic aid should realize that Ethiopian colonialism cannot be made viable by any amount of economic assistance. The future of the region lies in the hands of the people who are fighting for self-determination, independence, and social emancipation. The OLF is engaged in fostering people-to-people relationship in the area. The OLF enjoys fraternal relations with genuine and revolutionary national liberation fronts in the area. We enjoy good relations with the Eritrean Revolution and have been recipients of assistance from the Eritrean People's Liberation Front. Similarly, friendly relations exist between our front and the Tigray People's Liberation Front. We are interested in developing these relations and to increase our areas of cooperation in concrete terms. We consider that the growing level of our cooperation will culminate in the formation of a united front. This is why the OLF published its stand on the issue of a united front and continues to explore ways of realizing it soon. Such a policy will help in formulating a new, fair, and lasting relationship, inter-people relationship in the Horn of Africa region. And the success of this process is inevitable. The Oromo people, in collaboration with other colonized and oppressed peoples, will put an end to Ethiopian colonialism and pave the way for peace, stability, and prosperity. The sooner that everybody, including members of the Ethiopian community, realize this inevitability, the better. The Oromo people shall no more bear with economic exploitation, political oppression, and repression in the name of a fake unity. An independent Oromia And a normal society free of exploitation, shame, degradation, misery and ignorance is in the making. Once more, let me conclude by congratulating the members of the Union of Roma Students in North America for organizing this event on the occasion of their 10th anniversary. And let me express my wish for their success in the struggle in which all other Oromo nationalists joined them. Down with Ethiopian colonialism, down with imperialism, Oromia shall be free.